give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Clark County area, or looking for a new church home, invite you to make that job your new church home. This being a holiday weekend and the celebration of the birth of our nation, there's a couple of changes in our worship this morning. The first one is the prayer of the day. We will not be reading the prayer of the day that is printed on the today's reading insert, but I will be reading a special prayer for the national holiday. Then when it comes time to the intercessory prayers after the creed, once again, this will be a special prayer for Independence Day, which does not have any responses, so it will be like the old prayer, we used to do prayer at church, where we just pray straight through. But we do begin, as always, with the order of confession and forgiveness, preparing our hearts and minds for worship. So I'd ask that you please turn to page 94 in the front of the red worship book, and I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess
that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name.
Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We now begin our worship with For the Beauty of the Earth, hymn number 879, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 879, in the back of your worship book, the large numbers at the top of the page, from the middle of the book to the end.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is July the 3rd, the day before the birthday of our country. Our opening hymn is For the Beauty of the Earth, written by Folliot S. Pierpont in 1864, an English author, and he's celebrating the beauty of God's creation.
Your stars have well. also with you.
Come
second reading.
The second reading is from Galatians chapter 6. My friends, if anyone is detected in a transgression, you who have received the Spirit should restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness. Take care that you yourselves are not tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. For if those who are not nothing think they are something, they deceive themselves. All must test their own work. Then that work, rather than their neighbor's work, will become a cause for pride. For all must carry their own loads. Those who are taught the word must share in all good things with their teacher. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For you reap whatever you sow. If you sow to your own flesh, you will reap corruption from the flesh. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So let us not grow weary in doing what is right, for we will reap at harvest time if we do not give up. So then, whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, and especially for those of the family of faith. See what large letters I make when I am writing in my own hand? It is those who want to make a good showing in the flesh that try to compel you to be circumcised, only that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. Even the circumcised do not themselves obey the law, but they want you to be circumcised so that they may boast about their flesh. May I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision nor uncircumcision is anything, but a new creation is everything. As for those who will follow this rule, peace be unto them and mercy and upon the Israel of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now time for the gospel. Our pastor is Pastor John Pollock. He's reading the gospel for today. It's the seventh Sunday after Pentecost, July the 3rd, the day before July the 4th, our nation's birthday. We're celebrating the alleluia of the gospel of what we're supposed to do.
See, I have given you you authority to tread on snakes and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing will hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice at this, that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you quickly. First of all, a reminder of Christmas in July, July 24th. As is custom, we ask that you bring non-perishable food items to worship service. To restock the pantry. If you've received the newsletter already, you know that I asked for this service. When you arrive, just come forward and place the non-perishable food items there on the steps of the altar. And if you go to the drive-in that Sunday worship service, there'll be a truck to the entrance to put the items in. Also, our friend at Ohio Valley want you to know that you may use the parking lot right next to the building. The gate is unlocked, the maintenance man unlocks it on Sunday, so you can park near the portico and then just walk through the gate down the sidewalk and into the back door. That way you're parked in a enclosed parking lot. So feel free on Sundays to use the parking lot right next to us that Ohio Valley recently put in. At this time, I ask that you give your attention to Jeff as he provides our special music for this Independence Day week.
Thank you.
mercy and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In our second reading for today, in that sixth chapter, the seventh verse, St. Paul gives us those words, "Do not be deceived, God is not mocked, for you reap what you sow." As we gather together for the 240th celebration of the birth of our nation, the 240th anniversary, there are those who ask, what is America sowing? What is America sowing in comparison to its foundation and to its history? Some see now as a time of turmoil, a time of fear, and a time of confusion. Many see America as a great ship upon the ocean of the future, but a great ship without a rudder. And so instead of being able to plot a course and go straight to that course, having no rudder, we simply are being battered about by the waves and going in whatever direction the current happens to be going at that time. So, what is America's sowing? And what is our situation? And what can we, as followers of Jesus Christ, do about it? Before his assassination, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. gave a sermon in which he was speaking about America. And as we listen to his words, we see just how prophetic he was. In this sermon, he said, first of all, quote, "We've ended up building guided missiles and leaving misguided men." And we see that today. We see a lot of people who are misguided. We have missiles that we can send pinpoint accuracy. We can send them down the chimney of a building. But we have so many people who are misguided as to what life is all about and what their responsibilities are. He then said, quote, speaking of America, "She has allowed her technology to outdistance her theology. She has allowed her mentality to outrun her morality." Martin Luther King, in this sermon, was reminding us and calling us back to the Judeo Christian heritage from which our nation was founded, back to that heritage of values and morals, that foundation of laws based not just on ideas being made up, but based on the Ten Commandments and the teachings of our Lord Jesus Christ. But where are these values today? Looking at Dr. King's words, we see society filled with many young men and women looking for the meaning of life in all the wrong places instead of where they might find answers. Our vast advances in technology have not stopped to consider the fact that this technology invented for the good at the same time can be turned upon us and used for the bad with very bad consequences. One area where we have made advances that have been good, but at the same time, because we did not look at it closely and put any kind of ethics or morals on it, is now turned into a Pandora's box, is the technological advances we have made in the field of human reproduction. Through technology, women who had a hard time becoming pregnant can now become pregnant, and that's wonderful. But in this process, we've also have a number of women who have decided they want to raise a child by themselves, without having a husband, without being in the traditional family. And so they go to a clinic, and they become impregnated, and raise a child. Now that in itself is not bad, but here is the moral and theological dilemma of this. Men go to these clinics and give hundreds of petri dishes so that women can be fertilized by them. No, I don't know what kind of tracking they keep with this, but suppose we had two single women, Betty and Brenda. Both of them want to have a child, but they don't have a husband. They're not interested in a husband. They're not courting anyone. They're not really interested in a relationship. And so they both go to the same clinic, and they both become pregnant by the same male donor. Now, both of their children are born. Betty has a girl, Brenda has a boy. They turn 18, they graduate from high school, they go off to college. In college, they meet one another and fall in love. Now we have a moral and theological dilemma. They are half brother and sister. How can they be married with all the ramifications of families marrying within each other? We have seen the results of families that marry within each other, first cousins. Of course, the law doesn't allow brothers and sisters to marry. So here you have a half brother and sister who fall in love, but they didn't know they were half brother and sister. And what is the theological implication? What is the moral responsibility of these fellows who get paid to be these donors, being the father of all these children, and they're not paying for it? They're not putting up one cent for that child's education, for that child's medical insurance, for that child's development. So this is what Dr. King was saying. We've allowed our technology and our mentality to outrace our theology and morality, so that we find ourselves now in dilemmas that how do we get out of it? How do we solve this problem? How do we keep track? So that a young woman and a young man will know that they had the same father, whoever that was, and that they are half brother and sister. We also have a problem today in our nation, besides moral and theological problems such as that, and that is the problem of those who are trying to remove God totally and completely from our lives. Taking God totally and completely out of the marketplace, out of politics, out of our jobs, out of our recreation, out of everything we do. And it's all based on this non-constitutional phrase, separation of church and state. And you can search the Constitution until your eyes are bloodshot, and you can stay up for day after day looking for that phrase, and you will never find it. Because it is not part of the Constitution. In 1803, Thomas Jefferson, the third president of the United States, received a letter from a group of Baptists in Danbury, Connecticut. Danbury had a large Congregationalist presence in Danbury, and these Baptists were afraid that the Danbury government was going to make them become Congregationalists. Now, many of you are not familiar with Congregationalists because they, early in the 60s, merged with some other congregations that eventually formed the United Church of Christ. But at the time, they were rather large, especially in New England. And so these Baptists were writing President Jefferson, and in his response, he tells them that a person's relationship with God is their own business, and that government has no right to tell them how to worship. And so the First Amendment created a wall of separation between church and state so that the government could not dictate to the church what it would say, what it preaches, or how it worships. As you read his letter and the tone of the letter, you can tell that Jefferson is defending the right of the church, not the right of the state. He's defending the right of the church to do what it wants within society without government interference. But somehow, they took this phrase and made it sound like this was the law of the Constitution. Yet, James Madison, the father of the Constitution, the man who is credited with writing most of it and having most of the ideas, two others were John Jay and Alexander Hamilton. But James Madison said this, quote, "Religion is the basis and foundation of government," end of quote. Now, how do we take God out of our society when the father of the Constitution said that God was the foundation of the Constitution? He was right. Then we have George Washington, our very first president. The man who knew better than anyone else the difference between the powers of the legislative branch, the judicial branch, and the executive branch, because he was the first one trying it out. He had the authors of the Constitution there to give him advice. He had the delegates from the Constitutional Convention. After his second term, he gave a farewell address to the nation. And in that address, he said these words, quote, "Do not let anyone claim the tribute of American patriotism if they ever attempt to remove religion from politics," end of quote. Now, who knows more what our founding fathers meant? The father of the Constitution, James Madison, our first president, George Washington, or judges in the 20th and 21st century? Which brings us to John Jay. John Jay was with Hamilton and Madison, writers of the Constitution. He was also the first Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court. The very first. And this is what he had to say. Quote, "Providence, God, has given to our people the choice of their rulers, and it is the duty as well as the privilege and interest of a Christian nation to select and prefer Christians for their rulers." End of quote. Here is the first Chief Justice of the United States saying we are a Christian nation and that we should prefer to elect Christian leaders. It's just like when the Holy Spirit leads me to a certain Bible text to make my sermon. I don't just go into it blind. I go back and I look at commentaries and I see what St. Augustine said about that passage, and St. John Chrysostom, and Bernard of Clairvaux, and St. Gregory the Great, and St. Jerome, and Martin Luther, and Philip of Melanchthon, and other theologians of passage, see if I'm on the right track. And not trying to just say something on my own. And that's the way it should be with our government and our courts. They should be looking at what did the founding fathers say? How did they interpret this? What did they mean? What are we sowing? What the original intent was, or some new 20th, 21st century idea that has been influenced by ideas and traditions not of our founding fathers? So when St. Paul tells us that God is not mocked and that we reap what we sow, we need to pay attention. We need to listen and reevaluate where we are going and how much longer we as Christians are going to be quiet as society tries to kick us to the curb. Looking at St. Paul's word, when he says, God is not, or do not be deceived, that word means to forbid continuation of an action that's being done. It means to roam from the truth. It means to be led astray. As St. Paul uses it in our text, of course, he's talking to the Galatians about going astray from the true gospel of Jesus Christ. They have been battered by the Judaizers who tell them that the gospel is not enough. They need to be circumcised. They need to abide by the laws of Moses. And of course, he's telling them, man, don't be led astray. Don't be roam from the truth of Jesus Christ. Stop doing this action that you're doing of combining Judaism and Christianity. That's not what you're to do. As it applies to us today, it's saying the same thing. Don't run away from standing up for your faith. Don't run away from holding our politicians to the standard of our founding fathers. Don't shy away from standing on the Judeo-Christian foundation that this nation was founded on, which whose birthday we celebrate this week. When St. Paul uses the word mocked, that means you cannot outwit God. It means to turn your nose up at God. It means to have contempt for God. Our technology and our so-called superior mentality to ages gone by do not give us an excuse to disobey God, and certainly does not tell us that we can outwit God or turn our nose up at Him. As you review the pages of the Old Testament, especially the historical books and the books of the prophets, you see what happens to Israel and Judah when they turned away from God. You see what happens to Israel and Judah when they became arrogant, when they thought they knew more than God knows, when they thought they could rule their land by pagan ways instead of by the way that God intended. Because of wealth, because of power, because of influence, because of advancements, because of diplomatic prestige, both the northern kingdom Israel and the southern kingdom Judah thought that they could ignore God, could have contempt for God, stop worshiping God, stop praying to God, and even live as if God, the Father of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, didn't even exist. And they suffered the consequences. Such arrogance brought about the total destruction of Israel in 722 B.C. at the hands of the Assyrians, and brought about the exile of the southern kingdom of Judah at the hands of the Babylonians in 587 B.C., where for 70 years, as the psalmist tells us, they hung their harps on the trees and they wept by the waters of Babylon. And when their opponents asked them to sing, they could not sing because of their missing their homeland. So we need to listen to the words of St. Paul, and we need to listen to the words of our family times, so that what America sows and reaps will be that of benevolence, that of benefit, that of good harvest. The law of God cannot be changed. He made it, He enforces it, and He is the court of last appeal. Abide by Him and we prosper. Ignore Him and we see an increase in violence, in disease, in broken homes, in misguided youth, in abuse, and in suicides. To set aside God's law is to court disaster. But to return to God's law is to allow the Holy Spirit to work its will in the hearts and minds of our fellow citizens. Last week, we read chapter 5 of this letter. And in that fifth chapter, in verse 25, St. Paul said, "If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit." So if we live by the Spirit, as Christians do, or are supposed to, then we keep in step with the Spirit, which is to constantly proclaim Jesus Christ. As St. Paul reminds us in verse 10 of our reading today, quote, "So then as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are the household of faith." End of quote. So we are called upon to do good. To do good to one another, to do good to the stranger, to do good for our nation. And part of doing good for our nation is to call our nation back to its foundation. To call our nation back to those statements of the father of the Constitution, James Madison. To the words of our first president, George Washington. To the words of our first chief justice, John Jay. Doing good. We do God's will and sow the light and love of God in such a way that others may see it and come and join it. Doing good, we help put the rudder back on the ship of America so that as it continues to sail that vast sea of the future, with the rudder it can set a course and sail directly to that course, instead of rudderless being battered by the waves and carried by whatever current happens to be going at that time in history. It is up to us the Christian majority in America, to sow the good so that America may reap a bountiful harvest in commitment to God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Again, quoting George Washington, our first president, quote, "It is impossible to govern righteously without God and the Bible." End quote. That is our first president. That is the one who is given the responsibility of making sure the Constitution worked. This is a man who was given that awesome responsibility of seeing that this new nation, this new experiment, could be successful and be a light to other nations, so that as our ideas of freedom came from the freedom we have in Jesus Christ, that our ideas of freedom that came from God, we could share those with other nations so they could have freedom as well. The first president of the United States, the commanding general of our armies in the War of Independence, states that to govern correctly, we need God and the Bible. So who are we today to try to shove God out of our daily life? Who are we to try to shove God out of politics? Who are we to try to shove God out of the marketplace? Who are we to try to shove God out of our schools and our universities? Who are we to try to shove God out of our jobs and other aspects of daily life? Possible to govern righteously without God and the Bible, then we need to sow God's word and believe in God to keep our nation strong. As followers of Jesus Christ, we have been given the honor and the privilege to proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of all. We have been given that privilege and honor to share the good news with our nation so that we can sow that good news in the gospel. Do that which is pleasing to our Heavenly Father. So let us put that privilege and honor into practice. Let us share that good news, turning our nation back to its Judeo-Christian heritage and foundation, sowing that which is good, that which is well-pleasing in God's sight, so that we may continually say, God bless America, and see those blessings continue to come decade after decade as we acknowledge Him as the supreme Lord of all. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
We believe in one holy Catholic and
world to come. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, we stand today as our forefathers have stood before you in times gone by, celebrating our history and reveling in all the great things that our country has achieved. On this day, we rejoice in the favor you have graciously given us. We thank you for the blessings of liberty, for this generation, and for the generations to come. We thank you for our independence, peace, and for all those who have bravely given their lives in the defense of freedom and justice. We thank you that your gracious and provident hand has given us so much. Yet as a nation and a people, we have not always chosen the right way. We ask you to forgive us for these times. On this day, we commit ourselves to wholeheartedly honoring and serving you. With everything that we are, we lay our lives before you. Make us a generous people, a holy nation, a people set aside to love you forever. For the sake of the land of the brave and free and the peoples and nations of this world. Today, we do not presume your grace for our country. Our land is in need of you. Our people are in need of you. Our industry and business is in need of you. May we look only to you. This Independence Day depended on you. Please come now by your glorious Holy Spirit. Breathe new life into the sinews of this nation. May justice flow like rivers and righteousness like a never failing stream. Until the whole of our country is covered with your glory as the waters cover the sea. We ask all this in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and for all eternity.
The other ushers have come forward to collect the offering. John Dietrich and Karen Dietrich.
We welcome you to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is our celebration of the 4th of July. And we'll be singing the patriotic song, America the Beautiful, at the end of our service. It was written by Catherine Lee Bates. She was a professor at Wellesley College, and it was in celebration of the 400th anniversary of Columbus's discovery of America. She wrote this wonderful, beautiful hymn when she reached the top of Pike's Peak in 1892, 400th anniversary of Columbus's discovery of America. She was at Wellesley College, and she went by mule train and had a very difficult time getting to the top of Wellesley College, from Wellesley College to the top of Pike's Peak, and she wrote America the Beautiful, the wonderful hymn, Beautiful America, as Pastor Pollock has preached on today, founded by God and looking to God to do good, to love one and to love another. These are our principles. These are what we continue to believe in. And we are now celebrating Jesus' gift of love to us as he comes to us in Holy Communion, his body, his blood given up for us so we can be filled with love.
Again, I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. Let us pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts towards those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care and prepare us now to feast on the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. St. John practices an open communion. For all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, we believe his body and blood are truly present as we gather at his table, and are a community and your own individual congregation, you're invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of the Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 6 in your worship. The Lord be with you.
Thank you.
By our Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood, strengthen and preserve your true faith unto life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that we here receive the sacrament of his body and blood, may it abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration with O Beautiful for Spacious Skies, hymn number 888 in the back of your worship, hymn number 888.
This is our beloved hymn, A Beautiful for Spacious Skies, written by Catherine Lee Bates, professor of Wellesley College, in celebration of the 400th anniversary of the discovery of America, and also we're celebrating it today, 4th of July, the birthday of our country. Catherine Lee Bates wrote it from Pike's Peak, A Beautiful for Spacious Skies. This is the seventh Sunday after Pentecost, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Fourth of July. We thank you for watching St. John's on YouTube. Tune in anytime. We're happy to bring you this service. Our church offers a Christian school program for ages 3 and 4, nursery and pre-K. Call the school office if you're interested. 325-4311. That's 325-4311. Tune in again anytime. Thank you for joining us. This is the seventh Sunday after Pentecost. We hope that you'll come and worship with us in person. We're happy that you celebrated the 4th of July with us. We pray that God continues to bless you and keep you this day and all your days. We'll pray for you, continue to pray for us, support our YouTube. God bless. also note the beautiful flowers given anonymously today in honor of 4th of July. And we had our drive-in service every Sunday at 8 o'clock from all through the summer. Come join us at the Melody Cruise Inn. Come as you are in your car, or come to the sanctuary and worship with us at 10:30. We have our Sunday school at 9:15.